I'm Jana. I make content in Arabic and in English, and most recently I've been making more social commentary analysis on stuff like the Logan Paul and Casey Neistat interview, which is really fun.
Do you think Summer in the City has enough intersectional representation?
In the sense of the guests or the panels?
All of it.
I think it's difficult because it's always going to be a reflection of kind of the audience that's buying the tickets and who they're expecting to see and the people who are generally in the limelight a lot. I think potentially there could be more work done to counteract that and to actually say there are a lot of incredible people out there who are from really diverse backgrounds and really different walks of life that are doing incredible things and have incredible audiences and should probably get more of that limelight as well and that kind of be spread equally. It's just, how do you do that? It's quite difficult, I think, in my opinion, but probably more can be done.
Why do you think this particular panel is important?
For a long time, YouTube has been very male-dominated in terms of the creators, especially when it's different things like outside of beauty and hair, basically. It's like it's very, very male-dominated, and especially, I can imagine, with comedy as well. But I think it's also important to have this because we need to acknowledge that just because we're fortunate enough to not have to deal with a lot of the problems that people around the world have to face with and women around the world have to face with, doesn't mean that we shouldn't be talking about these things and we shouldn't be bringing these things to light and being kind of representing all different types of women online and in the world. So, like, you know, I was born in Saudi Arabia and we just got the right to drive there like 2 months ago. So I think it's really, really important to remember that those things still exist in the world and those issues still exist. And us as women who have more rights and more freedoms need to stand up for those voices as well. As women, when we do stuff that isn't typically, like, it's in an area that is male dominated, like gaming and tech, you kind of have the advantage to be that voice and represent those women who are interested in those things. And I kind of had the same I kind of had the same experience because when I started making Arabic videos, I was probably one of the only female Saudis to be making content on the platform at the time. And at that time, I felt like I was doing something really different and something important. And now, 2-3 years later, there's so many Saudi women who are now making content, and that's incredible to see. But it also then means that, okay, I have to look at my content and say, what can I do that's different? What can I do that's unique? Because now that space is kind of like, it's taken over by women, which is amazing.
I was wondering whether you ever feel pressure to have being a woman be a defining characteristic, like when you're making content and when you're in public and things like that.
When people think, when people are tweeting about like what they're going to wear to SITC and like, you guys look fucking gorgeous. And I'm like, oh, t-shirt and jeans again. So I think things
Hey.
Like
hey.
I mean, I'm wearing the same thing.
Yeah, kind of.
And like, I think I like, I get kind of this insecurity of like, do I am I being like a woman enough to, you know, to be at SITC and to like, to dress up like the other women are. So I think that definitely there is that pressure there in terms of a public event like this. Yeah. We need to be aware of the cultural pressures on women as well, because I think like for me, you know, the pressure that I feel from my parents and from the Middle Eastern society is there is one type of woman that you should be. And kind of growing up as like a super, super tomboy who like always had short hair, always wore kind of like boys clothes, and kind of like was into those kind of things. I had a lot of trouble growing up with my parents or with the society being like, no, that's wrong. That's not what you should be doing. So I think it's a lot of more of like an internal struggle of, is this really kind of, am I really being myself or am I being who other people are expecting me to be? And I think a lot of the time that's a cultural thing as well.
Yeah.
Since having that platform, have pushed myself more to be myself, to be able to, because I know that I've got that responsibility to show the audience that actually, like, if I don't do it, they might not realize that this is something that is okay. Yeah, so if anything, it's actually helped me kind of get out of that even more. when I started making content, a lot of the videos that I was making were to do with politics. They were opinionated, and it was, and I was giving my kind of my point of view. And back then, I think it was 2010, 2012, something like that. And I was getting so much negativity because I was a young, you know, teenager, and I was a woman, and I was talking about things that kind of were controversial, and I was opinionated. And I think from then, my content started to get watered down more and more because I couldn't handle that kind of criticism.
That pressure, wasn't it?
And it's taken me until now to be able to, you know, as a 24-year-old, to be able to say, actually, I do have a voice and I do have an opinion, and this is actually what I want to do. And there's this whole long journey to realizing that. And I think it's important to recognize that, you know, back then, even 5 or 6 years ago, it was totally, totally like a different landscape when you're posting content like that. Regardless of how successful you are, how intelligent you are, how good you are at comedy, or how good you are at creating content, the measures that people in society have put against you are totally different from that. They're actually looking at you. They don't give a shit that you've got subscribers, that you've got following, that you make an incredible content. They're like, yeah, but you don't have any makeup on, so. How many of you guys make YouTube videos? Yeah, cool. So a lot of you. So I think one piece of advice that I would give you guys is, please, please, please don't spend hours and hours and hours doing something that you think is going to do well because other people are doing it. If you're not enjoying it, there's, you know, you're going to waste so much time doing that. And you might actually get some success from it, but that's short term and it will be fleeting. And if you focus only on those numbers, that's just so bad for your mental health, because then you're going to kind of reduce the quality of your work and all of your hard work on those numbers, which can be very, very arbitrary at the end of the day. And if you want to have that longevity on YouTube, and if you really kind of want to do something that people will be able to see that you love and that you're passionate about, do something that you yourself love. And even if you had to, you know, at the moment I work a full-time job and I have to make YouTube videos on my weekends. And I remember I was making a video back a few months ago, and halfway through I was like, I don't want to make this anymore. As I was filming, I was like, this is so, like, why am I spending my weekend doing this? And since then I realized that, no, I have to do something that I love and that I'm passionate about, because it's a lot of work and it takes a lot of time and a lot of energy. So if you're going to do something like YouTube that does take a lot of work, it has to be something that you're passionate about. You want to be the best. If you're copying other people, you're always going to be not as good as they are at doing that thing, because that is them and that's what they're good at. So just even from a competitive standpoint, if you want to look at how successful you're going to be on YouTube, no one can be better at being you than you. Yeah. So that's kind of the best option and best strategy to go with.
Don't live one step behind, always being in someone's shadow. Just stand in your own light.
I don't spend hours and hours and hours watching YouTube just because I don't really have the time. But I will say Rowan, who makes a lot of content about... it makes a lot of like a variety of things, but LGBT content about women, and it's really just so interesting. I love watching content about stuff that is smart and educational, and something that I can actually learn from, because I think that when you get a little bit older and have to spend a lot of your time working and following what other people are telling you to do every day, being able to spend that valuable time actually learning and growing as a person and learning from other people is really, really important. So I would say go check out Rowan.